that we started 6 months ago, and we are continuing that thanks to, again, the strong support of some of our ecosystem companies. This is a program that allows us to fund travel for OpenStack community members who may not be able to make it to these events themselves on their own dime. And it's really important for us to make sure that if you contribute, if you participate, if you are part of the community and adding value to OpenStack, that that we find ways to allow those people to be able to be here during these summits. So thank you, VMware, for sponsoring our OpenStack travel program this time around. A couple housekeeping items. You should have a badge. If you were not able to get a badge before we started and you jumped the rope line and ran down the stairs, please go back and get one later. You'll need it this week. The badge has obviously your info on it. On the back, a lot of information that you might need to connect to Wi-Fi, when the schedule of events is. This actually pulls out and unfolds and has maps and all sorts of things. So useful information in your badge here. And just to talk a little bit about where things are, we are on the ground floor level here. And we have several floors of content. It's a big space. There are maps. We have staff around. Ask for directions if you need help. But I think you know, you'll find that that the layout is pretty simple once you get your head wrapped around it. We have a new mobile app. If you go to openstack.org/summit/mobile, you can find our guidebook mobile app that has maps and schedules and a lot of information in there that that will help you navigate your way around. And there's a web version as well. Something else that's happening this week that's exciting is our summit is really multiple events in one. We have conference sessions that talk about different technologies, different use cases, strategy, business concerns. We have the Design Summit, which is a really key part of this event. For those of you who are here for the first time, the Design Summit is a collection of working sessions where the developers get together, they discuss project issues, software issues, they plan out the roadmap and prioritize the work for the next 6 months for the next release. And those Design Summit sessions are really meant to be productive working events. If you want to go attend and participate, you're certainly welcome to do that, but please keep in mind that you know, this is critical time for our development teams to focus on the work that they need to do to, you know, keep making OpenStack great. The other thing that's happening this afternoon and on Friday is an ops meetup. And these are similar sessions to those Design Summit sessions. They are working sessions for operators who are running OpenStack, making use of OpenStack, so they can get together, share best practices, talk about how they are dealing with the different deployment models and the different things that they need to do to make their businesses successful with OpenStack. And that's new this time around. So if you are an OpenStack operator, please participate in that and give us feedback on it. We want to make sure that that you're getting value out of that. I was looking through some of the registration numbers, and I think we have somewhere around 600 or so operators here at this event. So that's, you know, a really good turnout, and hopefully we can serve you better this time around with some good content. We just had our Ice House software release, and it was our, you know, really great software release. It was very much focused on operational issues, kind of maturing the software, maturing the processes around how it gets developed and tested. And it was really exciting to have Ice House come out a few weeks ago. Tomorrow morning, Mark Collier is going to talk a little bit about some of what's in Ice House and some of the technical details around it. But I wanted to actually focus a little bit on the people who built Ice House. And there was some activity on Twitter last week, and some people were saying that we should have contributors come up on stage for Ice House. I think we might have too many of you to get you on and off stage in a timely fashion. But I do want to ask, if you made your first contribution to OpenStack in the Ice House release cycle, could you please stand? This is really exciting. Stay standing, actually. So contribution process in OpenStack is actually something that is really excellent. Code comes in, it gets reviewed, it gets tested, it goes through this process. Just as important as those incoming contributions are the reviewers and the process for checking that code as it comes into our source trees. So if you are a first-time reviewer in Icehouse, please stand as well. Yes, thank you. Now, not as many first-time reviewers. We need more people getting in and pitching in on the reviews. So that could be a goal. You know, if you're a contributor to OpenStack and are looking to take the next step, you know, maybe in the Juno cycle you can pitch in and start helping with code reviews. And finally, just anybody who got a contribution in Icehouse, please stand. Wow. Thank you, guys. This is part of what makes this event different. You know, this is an event where the practitioners and the software developers are here together to make OpenStack better. And so thank you guys very much for your work in Icehouse. That was only about half of the people who contributed in Icehouse. So that's your software development team, OpenStack. So thank you guys very much. Talking a lot about Icehouse there. Icehouse is software, and OpenStack is software. But I wanted to talk a little bit about some larger concepts today, and a little bit about how key software really is in our world. You know, software has completely changed the way that we communicate, that we make decisions, that we iterate, even the way we build physical things is different now than it was a few decades ago. And it has changed not just how we work, but it changes what we work on, it changes the cost of working on those things, and it allows us to do new things that we haven't been able to do before. I was talking about the contribution process for OpenStack. The contribution process for OpenStack is software. It's a number of open source systems that our core infrastructure team has integrated, expanded on, created new tools, and it allows us to take in contributions from thousands of developers all over the world to test them, to review them, to maintain a high level of code quality as all of that comes in, and to keep on hitting our release dates and bringing new features in. And it's very powerful when you think about that process. It's an incredible collaborative global process that's really made possible by software. And I was thinking about, you know, imagine if we were in a pre-software era. How would that work? You know, let's say that we're in the 1800s. And, you know, this is just for hypotheticals. We need to do a code review in the 1800s. So you sit down, you're a developer, and, you know, perhaps you are based in Asia. We have a lot of contributors in Asia. You take out your quill and your ink, and you spend a couple hours and you write out your code submission, and then you know you put it on a ship because it needs to be reviewed by a core reviewer in Georgia. So your 2 hours turns into 2 months and 2 hours. It gets to the West Coast. They put it on a train. Heads across the country. Stagecoach makes its way to your reviewer. He looks at it. And you had some trailing white space. So months later, you know, you finally get the notification. And you just, you know, you think about the turnaround cycle on something that simple. I mean, that is, it's a little bit of hyperbole perhaps. But, you know, that is really an incredible shift in how the world works today. And our code review system is something that is that's really incredible. If you go to review.openstack.org, you can actually see how it works. It's real time, it's live. You can see code reviews coming through there. People are pushing changes up all the time, reviewing them, making comments, and the whole cycle just turns so much faster. And that's a, you know, a very small example. But that's the power of software, and I think, you know, kind of a concrete way. And this is not something that, you know, is brand new. People realize this. And if we think about the technology industry, what have we been hearing about? We've been hearing about software-defined networking, software-defined storage. It's expanded to the software-defined data center. But I think that really, even that is kind of boxing it in too much. Because if you think about what all of this enables and where we're heading, we're really living in a software-defined economy. It touches every business, every industry. And in the software-defined economy, every company competes with a startup. The barrier to entry in every industry is dramatically lowered. And what this means is, you know, if you are a very large company, that isn't necessarily a benefit to you. That's not a competitive advantage. In fact, that can be a disadvantage. You know, if you are in the banking industry, you're having to compete with all kinds of technology companies now. Big media, having to compete with all kinds of startups and technology companies. I think Netflix recently won an Emmy. I mean, this is not just about delivering on-demand video, they are producing award-winning content. The automotive industry, you have Tesla. And you know, Elon Musk, I think, is an amazing innovator. He is not happy with just taking on the automotive industry, he is now taking on the Air Force. Even the Air Force has to compete with startups. And it's because, again, back to this technology shift, if you think about that first code review example, the expense and time and effort is extremely high. And when it's expensive to do that, it keeps experimentation, it keeps innovation low. When you can lower that expense, you can iterate so much more rapidly. And this is just, you know, it's kind of obvious, but when you can take a week and try something and find out if it works, you're much more likely to go out and make some bets and see how it works, see what works, what doesn't, than if it's going to take you a year to do that. What we're talking about is really increasing the velocity of money. So, you know, software is key to that. This is a little snippet from an OpenStack project. Can anyone recognize it? Swift, yes. It's the container server. So software is really key to that, and software is built by developers. We just saw a number of those who worked on the Ice House cycle. But it's not just about the software. You have to have an environment that can match the velocity of your software development to get that out in front of your users and your customers. This is just as important as the developers, as the software. You have to have the people and the systems that give them agile infrastructure. And if you have the software development practice and you have software developers who can turn out great code, but you don't have that agile infrastructure, it's kind of like having, you know, a Formula One car, a high-performance vehicle that doesn't have any wheels on it. It's an amazing piece of machinery, but it's not going anywhere. And so in the last 5 years, 6 years, we've seen a lot of growth in the agile infrastructure space. You know, this started, of course, with Amazon and their web services offerings. They really, I think, have pioneered a lot of approaches that that people have adopted and seen great value come out of that. And OpenStack, I think what's really incredible is we've gone from a model where, you know, 6 or 7 years ago, basically the only place that you could get that kind of agile infrastructure was from Amazon or from you know, the services. OpenStack has opened that up and made that possible for so many more organizations. So many, many, many more organizations are able to take advantage of these capabilities. And for many of those organizations, OpenStack is the engine of the software-defined economy. At our events, we often have users who come out and speak with us. We have users who participate throughout the week. And in between the release cycles, we have user meetups. We have operators who are doing all sorts of things to help build the community. But I think that what's interesting is it's not just about what these people are doing inside of OpenStack. And you'll see these illustrations all over the event this week. All of these illustrations are actual OpenStack users and operators who you know, are doing real business on top of OpenStack today. And there are some different signage and light booth areas where you can go and you can read about some of their stories. But what I think is really amazing is that in addition to what they're doing in OpenStack, in addition to how they are embracing this agile infrastructure, they're really thinking at a higher, more strategic level, and they're changing their businesses. They're thinking about things in a different way. It's a different consumption model. And I love to see this. You know, it's no longer just passive consumption of software that some vendor sells you on a 2 or 3 year cycle. These users are getting involved and they're helping to drive OpenStack. They're helping to change their businesses, and they are really making a difference in the industries that they play in. And that's really exciting to see. We have seen more and more of these users and operators participate in OpenStack. And so one of the things that we've wanted to focus on this year and at this event is getting them more involved and connecting them more and more. And when we were doing that, we wanted to think about some way to describe them, some way to talk about them. I used to run a lot of infrastructure, and one of my coworkers, he used to say I was basically a plumber of the internet. You know, it's a very vital job, but it's not necessarily glamorous. And so we were thinking, what is a good description of these people? And what we have started to call them are super users. The super user on a system is the administrative user with the highest level of access. And in many cases, these OpenStack operators are people who are super users on their systems inside of their data centers. But I think the concept is bigger than that. Because if you look at what they're doing inside of their organizations, they are using their access, they're using their capabilities to bring about change and to make their organizations better and more competitive in the software-defined economy. And we've had some of these users who have spoken with us before. Last year in April, if you were at our event, you might have heard from Bloomberg, Praveer Chandra, who spoke about the work that Bloomberg was doing. Comcast came and did an awesome demo. In that time, Comcast has gone from their initial deployment to being one of the top 20 contributing companies in Icehouse, which I think is really impressive, and it speaks to their commitment to OpenStack. But you don't have to be a code contributor in order to be a super user, in order to have an impact. When we were in Hong Kong, we heard from a number of companies that are based in China and other places in Asia, including Eric Yee from Ctrip, and he talked about some of the changes that he was driving inside of his organization. In addition to applications, the traditional applications, he demoed a great mobile app for their online booking software. He talked about how they were using OpenStack to overhaul their desktop service inside of their help center with 16,000 agents. And they were looking at cutting their costs in half. So that's a big change for his organization. And we have many, many more of these super users. They're here this week. I hope that you can find some and meet them and get to know them. But I'm excited to have a couple who are here live and in person and who are going to be talking with us today and telling us a little bit more about what they do. And in the past, we've done some kind of rapid fire presentations with these users. But today what we're going to do is we're going to sit down and we're going to have a little bit more of a conversation with a couple of users. So first of all, I'd like for you to help me welcome to the stage the head of private cloud enablement at Wells Fargo Bank, Glenn Ferguson. Don't call it a comeback. I've been here for years. I'm rocking my peers. What's up with your fear? Making the tears rain down like a monsoon. Listen to the bass go boom, explosion. Overpowering.
Love the music. Ben Horowitz would be proud of that.
I love Cool J.
These shows have gotten so much more polished. I mean, did you see that? I walked over there and all of a sudden, bam, chairs on the stage. So, Glenn, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, glad to be here.
Could you tell us a little bit about your background? I know you've been involved in infrastructure for quite a while.
Sure. History repeats itself. It's kind of a common term. If I rewind 15 years ago, I was probably like a lot of the contributors here in OpenStack, except I worked for a small startup called LoudCloud, where we were trying to automate operations. At the time, it was data center, storage, cooling. But we really had a different approach in how we wanted to automate operations. And to your point about the super user, being an engineer, we would sit down with our network operations staff and say, show us what you do. How do you build machines? How do you monitor machines? How do you configure these machines? And it was our job to automate what they did. 15 years ago, you know, VM, you know, virtual machines weren't as prevalent. They were kind of in a test dev mode. And XML standards were kind of the open source of the day. You know, the big focus is on, we tried starting DCML, which is Data Center Markup Language, which was our version of open source, of trying to get everyone who played in the data center space a common way to describe infrastructure so we could perform that level of integration. So picked up a lot of experience there, carried that through, spent some time at Netflix, director of cloud engineering, spent some time at HP Cloud Services. And what really attracted me to HP Cloud Services was their adoption of OpenStack. It reminded me of the early years in Loud Cloud and Opsware and what we tried to accomplish. So you know, I've had quite a bit of experience in this industry, and I'm looking forward to, you know, continue to be involved in it.
Yeah, that's great. So, you know, you are a bank, obviously.
Yes, we are.
You're working there, and why do you think that the financial services industry and, you know, other organizations like yours are taking advantage of OpenStack?
Yeah, well, I think you touched upon it a lot in the presentation. Your infrastructure has to keep speed with software. Without that, you know, to your point, that the software isn't good. So there's nothing specific to the banks that a lot of other people aren't driving for, except, I would say, compliance and risk. You know, I'm a Facebook user, I use Twitter. For me, signing up is fairly simple. I give an email address, I give some voluntary information, and then I'm on my way. When you look at the financial institutions and what they do for the economy and the government as a whole, the know your customer, the amount of information we must collect, tying someone's financial instruments to a financial system, there's just a different amount of risk that's involved with that, a different amount of focus. If you look at what's going on in the world today and you know, kind of what the president is doing with Russia and trying to put some sanctions on them, a lot of that is financial driven. So there's a lot of focus on compliance and risk mitigation in that environment. You know, so for those reasons, I think having control of kind of below the line and what we do below that cloud has an effect to ensure that we're always compliant, things are always backed up, you know, they're securely stored, et cetera. So that might be the one difference from a financial services perspective, but you know, the other drivers, you know, why wouldn't you manage infrastructure this way, right? It's a better way of doing things. It's the consumerization of IT. Outside of work, these developers can use Amazon, they can use these public clouds, or they're much more efficient with it. But yet when they come into this enterprise environment, they're just kind of bogged down and baffled as to why they can't get that same level of efficiencies.
Right. Yeah, so there's still the desire for that same level of kind of control and flexibility. But how do you balance that with the needs that you were talking about for compliance and the regulations? And where does OpenStack fit into bridging that divide?
Yeah, OpenStack is a cornerstone. You know, I mentioned the line, and what I mean by the line is the API. Above the line is where the developers are interacting and managing infrastructure through software and tools that they use today. But below that line is where the cloud operator plays. Below the line is where you define your quality of service, your racks of hardware, targeting workloads. But that's also where we build in compliance. We are fundamentally different than a public cloud provider, and I can say that because I've played in both worlds. You know, public cloud providers, I can give you a VM and you're on your way, here's root, do what you need to do. In a highly compliant environment, it's much more than that. It's patching, it's auditing, it's reporting, it's compliance. So using OpenStack below the line to enforce some of these, you know, best practices and security is great for us. The developers work above the line, they're using web services, they're managing infrastructure through software, but yet below the line is where we build in and bake in the compliance that's needed in this environment.
Right, okay. So how has OpenStack, you know, you talk about above the line and below the line, how has it changed your vendor interactions and how you sort of have vendor relationships and drive those decisions about that technology below the line?
We certainly let our vendors know that we are deploying OpenStack as kind of our cloud operating platform, for lack of a better term, and our desire, you know, for these vendors to fully embrace and support that. So I would say, you know, if I had to sum it up, that's probably the way that we engage our vendors is being upfront, letting them know where we're going, how we're using OpenStack, why we're using OpenStack, and that's the area that we want to drive forward.
Right. Now, we know that there are financial services organizations that are using OpenStack, but you are the first one to actually join us from a major bank and talk about what you're doing. Why are you doing that? Why are you here today? I mean, I'm glad you are, but.
Yeah, no, I'm glad. And I think it gets back to the previous question. You know, this is a community. I was hired by Wells to run a business and bring the best solution forward. And it's in my best interest to be at these conferences and let the community know that this is what we're using. Put our use cases out there. Everything that happens in parallel with Wells Fargo could happen in parallel with many other engagements and companies. So it's the collective mass of the community that everyone benefits from. You know, I'm not a developer anymore. I couldn't have stood up earlier when contributed to ICE House or anything. So this is my form of contribution. Letting the community know this is very valuable. Letting the community know what our use cases are, and we're trying to run a serious business on this technology. So that's the primary reason that I'm here.
So my last question, as we look at this shift that's happening in the industry, do you feel like inside of Wells Fargo, the infrastructure, the back-end systems, this technology stack that we're talking about is really becoming something that has strategic value to the larger organization?
Most definitely. The agility, the speed, really allowing the developers to modify that software in lockstep with the infrastructure, speed to market. We have competitors. We're a large bank. We have targets on our back. There's disruption happening everywhere. We're doing our best to stay competitive on all levels. And this is certainly, technology is a key component of any business, certainly financial services. So this is something we have to do to remain competitive and be flexible and agile in this environment.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Glenn, for joining us.
All right, thank you. Appreciate it.
Good to talk.
Thanks, everyone.
We have another user that is here to speak with us today. And he comes from a company that has one of the probably most beloved brands of all time, the Walt Disney Company. Please help me welcome the Director of Cloud Services and Architecture for Walt Disney Company, Chris Lani. Chris, thank you for being here with us. Could you tell us a little bit about what you're doing at Walt Disney Company?
Sure. I normally actually tell a story in response to that question, but I'll give you the quick version. You can go home and go to WordPress and register and build out a little website. You can go register DNS, license art, buy some plugins. You can spend 20 minutes with a credit card and have a completely set up web presence. You can go to work and you can submit tickets and fill out process exception request forms and get your boss to respond to an email and click something, and you can wait and wait and wait. As an entire industry of technologists, we have spent a long time empowering people much better when they go home than when they come to work with their technology. And what I've been trying to do is change that. Inside of Disney, outside of Disney, I'm like many others, I'm sure, in the audience, are trying to lead a revolution to help empower people when they come to work with technology.
Yeah. So we've talked a few times, and you said something that was kind of funny, and I actually made a couple of slides here. You said, everybody's familiar with this triangle. Has everybody seen this before? You have the triangle, it's good, fast, cheap, and you get to pick two. And what you said is that triangle now looks like this. It's just fast, fast, fast.
It's funny. If you look at what any business needs these days, if you're dealing at all with information, you need speed. That's what everybody craves. If you give somebody enough fast, they can make their own cheap. They can get their product to market quickly. They can respond to market demands and changes. They can be the first candy game on Facebook instead of the second candy-related game on Facebook. You can make your own cheap by just increasing your revenue by just getting to market more quickly and being able to work faster. You can make your own good by shrinking your dev cycles. You can change things all the time by only changing little bits at each time. Move to more continuous integration, continuous delivery models. So product quality goes up. So if you just give somebody the faster lover's pizza with an extra helping of faster on top of it, they'll go make their own good and their own cheap.
Yeah, I love that. Faster lover's pizza with an extra helping of faster. That's one of my favorite descriptions of it. So, you know, you're talking earlier, you were talking a lot about, you know, how it shouldn't be easier for them to be more productive at home than at work. You know, you're talking about lowering barriers, and it actually reminds me of an interaction I had one time. This is, you know, a few years back when I was at the Rackspace Cloud, and I had gone and spoken at a conference, and very large corporation, one of their IT leaders walked up to me afterwards, and he said, "You're creating problems for me." And I said, "Sorry, you know, what's going on?" And he said, "My developers inside of my company are going and signing up with your service and putting workloads on your services. And I need you to stop letting them do that." And I was like, "Well, how would you like me to do that?" And he said, "Well, I don't know, blacklist, you know, xcompany.com email addresses from being able to sign up." And I was like, "But they'll just use a personal one." And he's like, "Well, you know, blacklist IP blocks." And I said, "Well, I mean, it seems like they're looking for something, and maybe that's what, you know, like the conversation we should have is figure out, like, how can you deliver what they're looking for through a way that meets your requirements?"
Yeah, absolutely. The you hear, anytime you get technology people together, there's this discussion of shadow IT and how it's a bad thing and you need to, you know, shine the light into the corners and eliminate it. And that's crazy. It's like the little tablets that you chewed when you went to the dentist at age 8 that showed you where you weren't brushing properly. Shadow IT is awesome because it shows you where your opportunities are, right? Where your service is not market competitive, where are they not compelling? How are you not enabling people to do their jobs? You know, we hire amazing, passionate, driven people, and then we put mountains of obstacle course and process in front of them, and we shouldn't do that. You know, and I don't mean we, because, you know, we're trying to fix that, but everybody should try to fix that.
Yeah, it seems like there's a lot of stick out there.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
In the IT world, and you know, if we change that more to carrot, if we change that more to enablement, then we end up with a I think, you know, a more empowered set of technologists.
Sure.
So, you know, I had the slide up earlier of the sponsors that are here, and, you know, that's a portion of the ecosystem that participates in OpenStack. And one thing that you know, I've heard before is people, they look at OpenStack and they are concerned about how they're going to get started in OpenStack, how they're going to make use of it, because it's a big set of technologies. But there are a lot of people out there who are able to help you do that. And I know that you have an interesting story about that as well. I mean, what has your experience been with kind of working with OpenStack and the vendor ecosystem?
I was our virtualization snake oil guy too back in 2007. And, you know, we had worked with our hypervisor for about 6 months before we felt confident enough to put our first production file server on it, right? And when we deployed OpenStack, we didn't have the time to do that, right? It was you know, the whole point is let's go fast. So we engaged a company called MetaCloud that we've been working with and had great success with. They take OpenStack, they add to it. You know, there's some things that aren't finished yet. They contribute back, you know, to the project, and then they'll deploy and run it for you in your data center. So it gave us a very quick. We went from month one looking at technologies, month two POC, month three deployed. At the very end of that month, we launched a pilot and ran a pilot of,
wow,
of OpenStack as infrastructure as a service.
Yeah.
So you can go very quick, and you don't have to staff up a whole big department of people to do the operations and all that kind of stuff for you. So it's a nice model, because if the whole point is speed, right, and trying to deliver that to people, you want to operate in that same agile model yourself.
Right. Okay. Last question. I want to ask you the same thing that I asked Glenn. You know, when you look at this infrastructure and the way that your business is moving, the trajectory that it's on, does it feel to you like those backend systems and those servers and storage systems and everything, you know, all of that stuff that used to just be in a closet somewhere, is becoming more strategic and more recognized within your organization as providing value?
I think there's not anybody who works with any sort of digital information that doesn't understand that it's important, all that stuff. I also don't know anybody who works with those things who wants to care about all that stuff, right? So, you know, it's becoming really important, but it also isn't something that people want to spend time, you know, worrying about, right? It's more like the dial tone, where it just has to be there and has to work, but you don't, you know, oh, thank goodness the dial tone is still on, right, when you pick up your phone. That's an outmoded example because I haven't heard a dial tone in probably 9 months. But but yeah, it's yeah. So yes, it's obviously of strategic value, but it's also something that you want to provide as a utility service, right, where when you plug something in, it just works and goes.
Yep. Okay. Well, great. Well, thank you again for joining us, and we're happy to have you here at the show this week.
Thanks a lot.
So I'm glad we had Glenn and Chris join us, and we have many, many other users that are here. If you are looking at getting involved in OpenStack and want to speak with them, please, you know, track some down and find out about their experiences. It's a really great community to be part of. I'm actually going to take a little break now, and we're going to have a couple of our headline sponsors who are going to come up here and speak. I'm going to be back in a little bit, and I have some announcements that I'm going to be making about some new initiatives that the foundation is launching this year. So stick around for those. One of the things that we did before the event this time is we actually got a number of these super users to sit down with us and talk about their experiences on video. And we're going to be playing these videos throughout the general session this morning, as well as tomorrow. And so I want to go ahead and play this first one where we hear super users talk about the advantages that they see with OpenStack.
The primary impact of being part of and leveraging the OpenStack community is the reason we did it in the first place, which is velocity of our application development. We are delivering new features, new products, far faster than we ever have done before.
We have hard deadlines, we have hard air dates for TV shows, so you know, being able to shift and adapt that compute infrastructure, that storage infrastructure, that networking infrastructure, was a tremendous advantage.
One of the advantages that kind of OpenStack allows us is for our developers to kind of iterate faster, be able to get better products out to our customers quicker, and that speed and agility is something that we find very important.
We're in a highly volatile, highly competitive business, and I know everyone says that about their business, but you're dealing with shows that only last for 6 months. And you have to design a custom workflow for that show. So having an infrastructure that can change means that we became more profitable as a business. And hopefully the quality of life of our employees also went up as a result of that as well.
It's pretty key to what we're doing, both internally and externally. And we're deploying our entire platform directly to OpenStack, sort of all at once. So we're able to stand up an entire platform environment just with like one command.
I think the big impact for Bloomberg in using OpenStack and looking to the future is going to be in how we're actually going to be able to expand the services that we deliver to our customers by using OpenStack infrastructure. Again, through the agility and the flexibility that it gives you, it actually allows us to start delivering new things to our customers.
With OpenStack, we've deployed several OpenStack clusters, which we're making available to internal developers to work on their new ideas, and also in production to push out those ideas, you know, from the development side into the production side with sort of minimal amount of fuss and energy.
OpenStack has given me a future that 3 or 4 years ago I didn't think was going to exist.
So I love hearing stories from our users and operators. And Guillaume, who you saw there at the end of the video, he's actually going to be here speaking on stage tomorrow morning. So come back and you can hear some more from him. But first of all, it's time for us to get into our first headline keynote. And our first keynote speaker is someone who has spoken at the OpenStack summits before. He's been involved in OpenStack for quite a while. He is on the OpenStack board of directors, and he's had many titles, but I just heard one that I think might be my favorite, which was the spiritual leader of OpenStack at Rackspace. So please help me welcome to the stage from Rackspace, Troy Toman.
Wow, look at this room. It's an amazing sight to see. We have a lot to celebrate as a Rebel Alliance. We have more members, we have more active contributors. We still need more reviewers, but we've got a lot more capability, and most important, we've got more users. It's an amazing progress for 4 years, but unfortunately, we're really just at the first stage of this journey. Or as Han Solo said, that's no moon. We may not be facing the Death Star, but we're far from being able to declare victory on what we're trying to do here. We really just won the right to compete. And we know some large proprietary cloud vendors have earned that right too. And they're pushing their version of the future, and it doesn't include open source. The top three proprietary cloud vendors have committed to spend $25 billion on cloud in 2014 alone. And they've got money from their established revenue streams to fund that investment. They've also got thousands of developers. So we may have our thousands, but they're bringing them too. And they don't worry about trying to achieve consensus. They execute relentlessly. So we've got some pretty stiff headwinds. But I think that the battle's far from over. You know, it reminds me, I guess it's good to reflect back to the 90s. This was not my first software job, but I was at Sun Microsystems working on Solaris when I first heard of something called Linux. It sounded like a really interesting science project. But, I mean, it was obvious that Solaris was dominating the Unix space. Windows was rising on the server side. Everybody just wanted stability. Nobody needed to innovate. It was an operating system. They'd been around forever. But you know what? The internet was emerging. And it was changing everything. And the next thing we know, Linux is crucial to the ecosystem that we all depend on. I think OpenStack is in one of those moments right now. People are saying we don't need to innovate, but the world is changing again. You just heard it from Jonathan. We're moving to a software-defined world that is going to change things in ways we can't imagine, so we're certainly not done. And that's why I think OpenStack can be something much more. I've used a term as I start thinking about this called the Planet Scale Cloud Operating System. And this is really a vision that is much bigger than one single cloud that battles it out feature by feature with everybody else. What we're really talking about here is the future of the concept of cloud computing itself. How we evolve and deliver that. This is a cloud that needs to open the door to the Internet of Things, and I believe what we're really building here is the backbone for that architecture of the future. And I'm really excited about what it does for both the users as well as the providers in terms of what it gives them. Hopefully, we end up with users that get code and solutions that are bulletproof at scale, that provide real interoperability, and probably most fundamentally, a choice. As a provider, we get a platform to build on, to innovate on, and differentiate on as we try to explore the boundaries of where this goes. And we're going to start to see new kinds of specialized clouds emerge from all of this. I mean, you can think about the dimensions of things that you might do to tailor a cloud in this environment. Now, obviously, Users want the ability to have some knobs and dials on this, but we can't always provide it in one single solution. But the customers I talk to really envision having this choice and having the flexibility to move back and forth in their own way. From the service provider perspective, looking at it from Rackspace, obviously we're going to optimize a managed cloud, provides fanatical support to all the users that need that type of interaction. But you can see an environment where somebody else might focus on usability, making it simple, making it cheap. Maybe you've got some really cool GPU high-performance hardware for Bitcoin mining. There could be all kinds of specialized clouds in this environment. But where we lose out is if I think we think that that's one cloud. Because in the planet scale cloud, I think what we're talking about is not separate isolated clouds, but a lot of clouds that are running OpenStack. And if we do it right, that means they're interoperable. They come together. And I'm not just talking about between public clouds. I'm talking about private clouds and public clouds. I'm talking about metal and virtualized clouds and all of these things starting to integrate together, that the users have choice and the ultimate flexibility. They get the best fit for the workloads they need. Now, I'm not the only one with this idea. We see this catching on. Just listen to what some of the world's leading researchers are saying about their vision of the planet scale cloud.
OpenStack's momentum is impressive.
I think that the momentum is huge.
OpenStack as a phenomena has really taken hold.
OpenStack has changed the way we think about what we do and how we do it.
So at CERN, we see the need for OpenStack because we are looking to provide flexible computing facilities for 11,000 physicists around the world.
OpenStack is the clear leader in the infrastructure as a service space. And so if you want to configure a cloud in any kind of serious way, you're going to use it.
Notre Dame selected OpenStack for our cloud and for our infrastructure environment for the research computing requirements because we really need to be able to be dynamically flexible.
OpenStack needs interoperability because our users are expecting to be able to talk to OpenStack clouds in the same way, regardless of where those clouds are based. They want to be able to just choose a different OpenStack cloud and run the same program and be able to use that code portably across the world.
For scientists to collaborate at Notre Dame, at universities around the United States, at universities around the world, to collaborate with commercial entities and other nonprofit organizations, we have to have a language we can speak. And having that common language in a computing sense means having a common API like OpenStack provides.
So let's say we have a private cloud at Argonne and we want to go out and use a commercial cloud. If we can do it with minimum fuss, that's much better for the user. That's much easier for the user.
OpenStack can become a worldwide cloud if we use the facilities that are part of the Icehouse release called Federation. Federation allows users to authenticate against one cloud and then use resources in another. This has been developed as part of an industry CERN collaboration with Rackspace under the OpenLab environment and is available as part of the open source release.
In today's world, research and collaboration is global. If we're going to have planet scale, you know, if we're going to be able to capture an Internet of Things, billions and billions of devices that are interoperating, that are communicating, that are transferring data between each other, to do that on a planet scale, we have to have big compute possibilities, we have to have big data resources, and we have to have the ability for big instruments and big devices and many devices. What OpenStack provides is a platform that as those new devices come on, we can add new modules, we can add new capabilities for OpenStack such that it can talk to those devices, it can come with new APIs so that our compute and our data and those devices that are coming and developing every single day over new networking infrastructure, we can get that planet scale, we can bring all of those into the fold, and we can make sure that as we go to, you know, devices and numbers that are far beyond values we're at today, we can still make sure that it interoperates and we can have a way to collaborate.
Interoperability. I can't talk to a customer today who doesn't tell me that the planet scale cloud needs interoperability. But I tell you, building an OpenStack cloud that's interoperable today is guesswork. It's guesswork for me as a service provider. It's guesswork for some of the users. For me, it feels a little bit like Luke Skywalker trying to train with a lightsaber. You never know where the next hit's coming from, which feature you're supposed to support in your release, which new extension or OpenStack module people are going to expect you to have in your cloud. And if you think it's hard for us as service providers, think about the operators and the users that want some base standard. And we need to give our customers and our OpenStack user audience a higher degree of confidence. And that's what DefCore is all about. DefCore is a process driven by the OpenStack board. It's a committee run by Josh McKenty and Rob Hirschfeld that I'm a part of. And it is a process by which we are defining the capabilities, the code, and the must-pass tests that are the minimum standards for all products that use an OpenStack label. This really becomes the basis for interoperability. It's not going to solve all of our issues, but it is an absolutely essential first step. Now, the way that we're determining what goes in these is based on four categories of criteria. First, this has got to be used. It's got to be widely deployed in public and private clouds for us to consider it to fall into the core definition. Second, it has to align with the direction that has been set and established for the future by the technical committee and the PTLs that run our project. We also need to make sure it plays well with others, that it's well documented, that it's easily understood and consumed by the people that ultimately pull this together. And then finally, we're taking a system-wide view, looking at all the components and the dependencies and how these things fit together to make sure that we understand the interactions and how to put this in place. Now, it may sound complicated to have all of these criteria and tests and pieces and stuff that goes together. So we're not stopping there. We're not just writing a document or putting out a definition. We've begun the RefStack project. And the RefStack project is designed to put together a set of tools and a website and reports that make it very easy for you to take Tempest and run it in a container, run the test, produce the reports, and understand where your cloud sits or where the clouds that you're potentially investigating for use are in this spectrum of support for core. This will have a feedback cycle where you can upload results to a website where we can track utilization, who's using what new features are becoming popular and on the rise. This effort is designed to be easy to use, public, and community-driven. Now, we've been working on this for about 18 months in various pieces, but we've got 6 months to really tune and lock this down and get it right. So we need all of you to help us refine the criteria and the tests that we're selecting in this process. We need you to get involved now so that all of this is cemented by Paris. Because I think it is absolutely essential that we have a definition of OpenStack Core by the end of 2014. Now, there's going to be sessions here at the conference given by Rob and Josh. There are blog posts by myself and Rob and a number of other people. The information is starting to get out there, so grab it. And where you don't understand it, grab one of us, ask questions, and get involved. And again, the basis of this is we want it quantitative. We want it data-driven. We want it easy to use, transparent, and most of all, responsive to the community. But that requires you to get involved. So that gives us the solid core. Now, if you listen to the press and even some of the conversations that we have inside the community, a lot of people would say, you know what? OpenStack should just stop right there. All we need is a solid IaaS. You know, I used to be one of those people. You heard me talk at San Diego. I had a lot of caution about new projects and about locking down the core projects that we had inside of OpenStack. But you know, history, both inside of OpenStack and outside, have convinced me that's the wrong point of view. Linux didn't survive just because of Linux. Linux survived because of an ecosystem that included the LAMP stack and all these tools that went around it to make it usable and accessible. It innovated along the way. IP tables wasn't started in core in the Linux kernel. It earned its way in there through a competitive environment. We can learn those lessons in OpenStack. So I think we need both this stable, well-defined core and a very rich ecosystem that populates around it. It's going to take that kind of innovation and extensibility and broadening of the community if we're really going to build the planet-scale cloud. So this ecosystem is going to be composed of core OpenStack, certainly, and a lot of other interesting OpenStack projects. It's going to include other open source projects that don't exist inside of OpenStack. We have to be sophisticated enough to understand this wide range of things. We can't take every project that matters to the planet scale cloud and cram it in to OpenStack core. And not every one of these things actually should be in an OpenStack integrated release. We need to get comfortable with the fact that there are valuable, important projects that are not going to be integrated, that are not even, in some cases, going to be in OpenStack, but nonetheless are important to this evolution and this path that we are on. I need to know that this is a community that is able to make sure that both a Cloud Foundry and a Solim can run well on an OpenStack cloud, and we leave it to the market to figure out the long-term answer. So how does this work for us at Rackspace? So about 2 years ago, we launched our version of an OpenStack cloud that built on some of the most stable projects in the system. And I'm happy to say we have benefited a lot from the success and momentum that's happened inside of OpenStack. To date, we have processed more than 2.4 billion API queries through our cloud servers offering alone, all going through a Nova front end. We manage more than 100 private clouds for customers built on OpenStack. And most of those customers are adding capacity and growing their use cases on a daily basis. So for that, OpenStack community, I want to say thanks. This has been a great start for us at Rackspace. But we're not stopping at that core IaaS either. We are continuing to grow our portfolio, taking advantage of the innovation that's happening in this environment. We have the first public cloud availability of Heat in a production basis. So you can use Rackspace Cloud Orchestration today, and it is running the Heat code from less than 7 days ago. We've also exposed Glance endpoints with our Cloud Images offering so that you can begin to use the Glance APIs directly within our cloud. And we've started deploying Neutron in all of our data centers, and we'll be exposing that endpoint to you as well for networking purposes. And finally, I'm committing that before the end of 2014, we will be running the Keystone code in production and not just supporting Keystone APIs, so that that vision of federated identity can become a reality. And this is all part of this demonstration of our commitment to DefCore and to aligning with what the community is doing and how we build our cloud at Rackspace. So that's a lot of the what about what needs to be done to get us to the planet scale cloud. I want to shift gears a little bit, and I want to talk about how we get there as a community. So this is actually a community that has really cared passionately about the how. Ever since we got together and started figuring out our processes and building our sort of representative democracy, it's been essential that we don't just copy what other people do. And I like to think the basis of this community is around trust and contribution. But as we're expanding our mission, as we're embracing new types of use cases, as we're embracing contributors that don't just submit code patches, we are going to have to change and evolve the way we think about these elements within our environment. But before we think about change, I need to remind every one of you that we've started out with an ability for all of you to have a voice in what happens inside of OpenStack. Every single member of the OpenStack Foundation has a vote in the elections of who gets on the board, as well as any bylaws changes that we are to make as we go forward. And we are going to need to make some changes. But we can't do those without you. So take advantage of the privilege of your vote and make sure that you pay attention to these changes that are coming and the elections in the future and take an active role in helping us evolve as we go. Now I want to dive into the topic of trust. This is going to be a tough one. We started out as a small, close-knit community where we all knew each other. Now we've got over 16,000 members of the foundation, and I'm standing in a room of over 4,000 people talking about where we're going in the future. There are a lot of new faces coming in. We all come from different companies, and you know, we all know the fact that most of those companies have a commercial interest in OpenStack. So we could start to batten down the hatches. We could start to take a defensive posture and make sure that all those people earn their way into our community, that they earn the trust that we give them and the respect and the ability to listen to their opinions. I've got a different suggestion. I think we take a different path. We go back to what got us here. And what got us here is the ability to trust and that people's motivation to make OpenStack succeed is more important than any individual or corporate agenda. We have to stay focused on the long-term goal, because this is a long-term fight. Now, this is related to another common and foundational element of the OpenStack community. We like to argue. Everybody nods their head knowingly. It's an essential part of how we get the conflict in the organization to sort out the right answer, to sort through the confusion, and to figure out how to move forward as a group. In fact, that conflict and that argument is the exact reason we don't need a dictator in OpenStack. But I want you to remember something as we move through that process and as you reflect on my words about trust. As Patrick Lencioni likes to say, conflict without trust, that's just politics. But conflict with trust, that's a search for the truth. So trust without contribution doesn't deliver the amazing stuff we've had today. So we need to focus on this as well. We have built an incredible system and ecosystem around developers that has attracted an absolutely phenomenal number of incredibly talented people to write code and build these products and keep maintaining and evolving them. We would not be where we are without the ability to recognize and incorporate these people's contributions into our culture. But as Jonathan talked about today, that's not going to be enough. We need to broaden our definition of contribution in OpenStack. We need to embrace operators and users as a part of our community. Now, we've done some great things. This is not a new initiative, but we have to continue going. There was an operator mini summit in California back in March. We brought a whole group of operators into a room, and they came up with a list of the things that they need our developers to focus on to make their lives better. We got good interaction among the operators and a good starting list of things to work on. That spawned the operator tracks that Jonathan's already talked about that are here happening this week. And there are design summit sessions this week where we're actually going to do something as crazy as put developers and operators in the same room and talk together. So we're making momentum here. We're starting to embrace users and developers with common SDK initiatives. The Win the Enterprise committee that the board is working on to go dive into requirements. So I think we're making good progress, and we recognize this as a necessary and logical evolution of the community. But there's a trap if we're not careful. The danger is we just set this up so that users and operators throw requirements over the wall, they land at developers' feet, and we hope that things get implemented the right way. I'm sure we've never worked on software projects where that's happened, but I'd argue if that's what we do, we're missing an amazing opportunity. We need to coalesce these groups. We need to bring them together. We need to share information and understanding, and ultimately, we need to create an environment of empathy and understanding within our community. We need developers that understand the pain of dealing with an operational issue at 3 a.m. We need users that understand how hard it is to put code changes in to a rapidly evolving code base in a new space. We need that information sharing that goes beyond just forklifting requirements back and forth between groups. And so just to echo Jonathan's words, find users, find operators, and let's bring this whole thing together so that we are truly co-creating the planet-scale cloud. So look, today, OpenStack is awesome. It's real, and we are absolutely on track. We are not done. The pressure's on. Other people have other ideas, and they are moving ahead quickly. And in some cases, they're coming after us. But I think we'll be able to claim victory. I am confident that I will get to stand up here one day where we can celebrate getting to where we wanted to go. We're going to do that because we are going to continue our environment of trust. We are going to value and expand what we think about when we talk about contribution. We're going to expand the community from which we get those ideas and those insights, and we'll have created this environment of empathy that is absolutely critical to getting to the next stage. That's what's going to get us there, and that's how we're going to win. We got a lot of hard work ahead of us, but I really look forward to the day where we can throw the last party. Thank you.
Like, there's tons of benefits to getting involved with OpenStack and with the community.
The nice thing we have with OpenStack now is there's a community in almost every city. So go meet your friends, get an understanding of what they're living through. The power of the open source community is you can talk to somebody else that's been through it.
There's always somebody somewhere in the OpenStack community that has done the thing that you're trying to do.
One of the things that attracted us to OpenStack in the first place was, as an open, flexible, loosely coupled system, it was possible for the community to add all of these things. I didn't rely on a particular vendor to provide a particular feature that they did in their own way, in their own time.
And what's awesome to see now is that when we go to these kinds of things, when there was the operator summit that they had in March, that there's lots of actual operators involved now. So there's lots of companies that are using it, and it's taken off quite a bit.
And so just having this wide range of skill sets and talented people writing software and testing software and implementing it and giving feedback and building it up, I think is a huge competitive advantage.
Being a super user means improving myself every day with the help of the OpenStack community. I now have the opportunity to work with other people that faces the same challenges as me as a cloud operator.
The people who are contributing to it, either as users or as people running the cloud, get great feedback from the OpenStack community. They do blogs, they help out on the mailing lists, and they give other users help when they have problems through things like ask.openstack.org.
So our participation in the community is, I'm going to call it in our enlightened best interest. By ensuring that I'm staying connected to the community and what they're producing, you know, the rising tide lifts all boats kind of metaphor, where everybody is kind of contributing to something that's growing, that's more than the sum of its parts to some degree.
The ability to be connected with the community is pretty big, and just being able to be very specific, and you know, no marketing, no PowerPoints, but you know, this is where we're going with the code, and the connection across the community has been you know, pretty passionate and vibrant. So for me, it's as being a super user, it's being able to connect, really, and drive technology forward.
I was afraid that Troy was going to give away some of my news from later, but he danced around it. So I'm excited. We have another headline sponsor who's a new headline sponsor that we haven't had before at our summits, and that's Dell. So joining us today from Dell, we have VP and CTO from the Enterprise Solutions Group, Sam Greenblatt.
Thanks, Jonathan. Yep. Good morning. It's great to be at OpenStack Summit. And what's interesting is I relived the days when it was maybe 500 people in the room. So it's fascinating. I love Troy's speech, and I'm going to play off of it a little bit. I'm going to explain one thing, and I want you to imagine this first. Steve Jobs, who was an old friend, used to tell a story I loved. When he was a kid, a gentleman down the street was an engineer at Hewlett-Packard. And what he did was he made Steve pick out two rocks. And he took the two rocks and he had a can tumbler, if you can imagine that. And he put the two rocks in with buckshot. And it ran all night. And when Steve came back the next morning, he found two beautiful rocks, totally polished. Having controversy, like Troy talked about, and having discussions that move towards progress is why people join OpenStack. And it's also why you're going to see us work with partners like Red Hat. I have Tim Eaton with me, who's someone I've known in the industry, and he's a great partner. Let me just start out by talking about where we see cloud going, and we're going to add another piece up there. It's called mobile backend as a service. This was coined by IBM. The other three were coined by NIST. And what we believe is we need to create that center, and OpenStack is how we're doing it. We need a on-demand, self-service, elastic, and measured service. We want to go from private to public. Other companies have said, hey, we'll take a non-public version and then add some proprietary software to it and call it enterprise ready. We believe the adoption of OpenStack that Red Hat is doing, keeping it purely open, and you're going to hear from Tim some exciting announcements today, are absolutely to our vision. And we are very concerned when companies want to take OpenStack in a different direction. Our cloud strategy is simple. We believe that we take a comprehensive approach by supplying cloud builders a facility to do an either a private cloud, on-premise, a community cloud, and we believe that we can do this through taking OpenStack, putting a PaaS layer on it, whether it's Solimm or OpenShift, and we also see the wave of containers coming. And between all those three aspects, we believe that we're going to deliver a multi-cloud management environment from our software group that will be second to none. Plus, we have consulting and application services. Let's talk about why we believe in OpenStack and why we want to be here today. It's a foundation to a new order. In 1962, a gentleman by the name of Thomas Kuhn wrote a book, and in there he coined the term paradigm shift. And all the analysts in the industry use paradigm shift all the time. Excuse me for a second. And one of the things that we believe in paradigm shifts is defining it properly. Going from Pepsi to Coke, since we're in Atlanta, is a shift. Going from water to bottled water is a paradigm shift. If you think about that, that's what OpenStack is. You'd be hard-pressed to find many companies working in the community, and we're proud that we have some key members in the community. And by the way, we argue internally about some of the projects. But in the end, what we try to do is we try to come to a common conclusion. And that's what the community is back about. That's why the rock's in the can. Now, do these perceptions sound very familiar? OpenStack is now unstoppable. It's a force in the IT community. It is a paradigm shift. And the rate that OpenStack is putting enhancements out there is incredibly impressive. So impressive that the community is growing robust and larger every day. Having witnessed Linux grow from 2% to 28% of the market, we see that community works. We watch Apache work. Apache runs most of the web. We believe that OpenStack will be the infrastructure as a service that everybody will rely on. We're seeing an uptick of adoption of OpenStack in the mainstream. I deal with enterprises all the time that are saying to me, how do I get an enterprise-grade OpenStack? That's one of the reasons why we did the Red Hat partnership. We are looking at companies like you saw this morning, Wells Fargo and Disney, adopting OpenStack. I could give you a lot more names that are on the list. That is far more many names than we had 5 years ago. And the visibility is good. It's making a lot of people realize that OpenStack and open source is good for their business, and we believe in enterprise adoption of it. So what our whole thing is, you see the two bridges there. We want to affirm that we will stay working in the community, having it over the first bridge, and we are going to bridge back in multiple ways. We are going to create upstream code with Red Hat for multiple OpenStack projects. And we will do it both as Dell and with Red Hat. And before I bring Tim up, I also want to talk about a couple of other small things. We will continue to support, continue to contribute. And what's more important is we want to create the richest infrastructure, because being a company, other companies out there, it is very hard to innovate at the speed that the open source community innovates at. We want to enrich it. What we want to do is create a bridge between the community and the distribution that Tim will talk about in a moment. And we want that bridge to go both ways. And we want to make sure that we learn from the community and the community learns from us. And by being one with the community, we will bring a much stronger product to market. We believe totally that supporting this effort is critical. And I'm going to talk about some of it in a minute. But Tim in his talk is going to have some very exciting announcements, and then I'm going to come back and talk about how we support the community. So my good friend Tim Yaden, unfortunately, he's the only one older than me in the room. No, we started in Linux a long time ago.
Tim. Thanks, Sam. And I'd like to thank, And I'd like to thank Sam, you, and Dell for first inviting us here today to join you, and also for the great partnership that we've built together. You know, the Dell relationship in Linux and open source goes back now almost 15 years. And today, that partnership has really been solidified by the shared vision that both companies have in terms of building a hybrid cloud architecture spanning inside and outside the firewall, all built on open source and open source components. As you'll see on the slide here, Everything in red are the things that we and Dell are jointly collaborating on as part of the OpenStack platform. As you may know, Red Hat has historically, for the last several releases, been the number one contributor, but Dell is incredibly active as well, as you can see here. Almost every dimension of the OpenStack platform we're jointly working on and contributing to. So I mentioned this shared vision that we both have about open cloud and open hybrid cloud, where we can serve enterprises inside the firewall. And as you know, you just look around the room, the pace of innovation has accelerated since open collaborative communities around open source technologies has really broadened its footprint. You see it here in every dimension. And we're committed to do an open source community around everything that we productize. And let me just point out three new things here for those you may not be aware. First and foremost, as I mentioned, the Ceph community under Red Hat Storage, that's the product of our InkTank acquisition made just a little bit ago. That broadens our ability to deliver on enterprise-grade virtualized storage across all storage models. Second, although it's not on the slide here, we recently announced a partnership with CentOS to create a sandbox environment combining CentOS and RDO for a community edition of our RHEL OpenStack platform that gives you a consistent environment from the operating system on up to do prototyping and evaluations and such. And then the third one, an announcement that we're making today, we acquired CloudForms. CloudForms is our hybrid management platform, cloud management platform. Today that we're announcing, we're formally open sourcing that and creating the manageiq.org community to enable collaboration around at the management layer. You know, one of the interesting dynamics is, and you know, I've been in the open source side of the industry since long before it was called open source, and we always run through these cycles around what should be open source and not. And it's not about the code, it's exclusively. It's certainly about that, because that creates a community of developers that can engage, but it's also transparency of the process so customers can understand where we're going, particularly in a context like OpenStack, where it's moving fast and you're making choices every day around what to deploy and how. All those elements, the embracing heterogeneity, that applies, we believe, at every level of the stack. Yet, we haven't seen much in the way of a full cloud management platform that's gone down the open source path. That's really what we're intending to do today with our manageiq.org announcement. And you can see, as depicted on the slide, it's a full cloud management platform that also embraces heterogeneity. It doesn't just manage OpenStack. It can manage virtualization KVM environments. It can manage VMware environments, Amazon Web Services, and even Microsoft. So it truly embraces heterogeneity to give you the flexibility and choice that you're looking for. And then the last thing that we in Dell believe strongly in, and it's been alluded to a couple times this morning, is that ecosystem really does matter. You know, we recognize that hybrid cloud architectures are going to be built, not bought, and that means we have to embrace a community of development that spans from independent software vendors, hardware vendors, solution providers, service providers. And it's part of our DNA and Dell's DNA to go work hard to jointly build that ecosystem. So with that, let me just wrap up my few comments by saying that, you know, Dell and we are committed to collaborating in the upstream, driving innovation across all those dimensions. We then work together to create real products. And, you know, together we're working hard to make OpenStack real for your cloud deployments. So, Sam, thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Tim. One of the things that I also want to tie back to Troy is you heard him talk about Dev Core, and I'm proud of Rob Hirschfeld, who's from Dell, who's working with Josh and Troy on that effort. So I want to thank him very much for his efforts. Let's talk about the Dell IT mandate. Dell has an incubation lab in its IT department. It's to look at the next generation of data centers. When we built it, with a central IT innovation concept, and we literally stood up OpenStack in our IT department. We are in very short order building upon it, and some of our new web services are coming out in an OpenStack environment. That is commitment to using it and understanding it, and also working with corporate and being able to show other enterprise users what we're doing with it. We built this in conjunction with our security practice, Dell Security. So we're pretty excited, and I want to also say that when you take a look at this, you got to say that in order to be committed, you got to be able to be committed in your own company to work on the projects and also use it internally. Dell sees real business impact from OpenStack. The incubation of our IT projects within our incubator is faster. We're addressing the core imperative that we gave to the group. It's now enhancing the user experience, and we're also creating labs for other parts of Dell to be able to use it, and they love it because we put a self-service portal in. Where's OpenStack headed and where's Dell headed? I don't have enough time in 25 minutes to tell you all the projects we're going to work on, but I will tell you that we're more excited about it than we've ever been. We want the next era to be called the OpenStack era. We also, at the same time, have worked with Microsoft on putting Hyper-V up on top of OpenStack. You're going to ask me why. There are enterprises that are absolutely committed to Microsoft. As you know, Red Hat worked with ESX, VMware, to put it on top of OpenStack. We're looking at OpenStack as part of the Linux infrastructure, so you could build out infrastructure as a service. The new cloud paradigm, which we talked about, which is IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, MBaaS, I love these acronyms, I can go on forever, and what we're looking at is now containers. And what you will see is the key to success are the people in this room. The key to success are the people in Round Rock, Texas, and around the world that work for Dell that have embraced this to bring value to the customer. You know, one of the things that I always get asked is, once you get up an OpenStack platform, what do I do next? And you saw us embrace PaaS through OpenShift. We have worked with Cloud Foundry also, but what we are looking at is customer choice. And we believe one is advancing a lot further and faster, so we're backing that. It's a truly exciting time at Dell. It is exciting because we're not trying to do it as a single company. By embracing another company that works with us, and by the way, it's not just Red Hat, we're working with Intel on this, and we're working with some other data companies, big data companies that'll be named later. The important thing is the communities are interacting. I'll give you one example of a community that I just spoke to last week. Those of you who know Spark, which is another data-intensive application, which came out of the UC system, we're looking at that, not just Hadoop. And we're looking at it with our partner, Red Hat. We're looking at it with our partner, Intel. And we're looking at it with their partnership with Cloudera, which we're also partnered with. So overall, what you're seeing is we recognize community is more than one. And we are absolutely there. And we have to extend the reach and range of OpenStack. And what is supposed to happen in open source, according to the famous book, The Cathedral and the Bazaar, is the bazaar created a new form of commerce? And we basically believe that you are going to create the next generation of IT. And the innovation is yet to come. And we believe, just as Troy said, we're in inning two. This is a long game. And when we get to the end, and I don't think there will be an end, people look back at it and say, it is a paradigm shift. And it's a paradigm shift to where the community and the enterprise become one because they're running and working in the same method. And that is something we're very excited about. So in essence, I want to close on this note. We will grow the OpenStack community, and I say we, that's the community giving back. As you know, Red Hat takes the community edition and basically creates an enterprise edition. And anything we do with Red Hat will go back to the community. Yes, we have proprietary software, but that is not going in our distribution. It will never go in our distribution. And anytime you put proprietary software in a distribution, it's called a fork. And we're not in for forking anything. We're basically in to working with you, helping us create a better OpenStack. Thank you.
Conversations with any vendor or any partner, we make sure that their product supports OpenStack, because if it doesn't, it doesn't fit our strategy.
If there's an external provider that we want to work with, as long as they're running OpenStack, we know that we can use them.
Even if they weren't initially part of the movement, they all seem to come into the movement.
We're always expecting, when we talk to a new vendor or an existing vendor, we're expecting them to participate equally in OpenStack. and then contribute their interfaces and make their software work within the pluggable architecture of OpenStack.
It helps solidify maybe the partner approach, where it's not just a vendor and a customer, but when both parties are involved in making the same thing better, I think it opens it up to some stronger relationships and some better conversations.
One of the primary reasons we did that, made that move, was so that we could leverage all of the tools and capabilities of all of the third-party software, open source software, that operates in that ecosystem. And I can use all those tools for my internal deployments. I can leverage all this stuff. I don't have to build it myself. I don't have to go to a specific vendor.
That, you know, cloud is bigger than any one given vendor. Therefore, it takes a platform that's open, like OpenStack, to be bigger than that, because it needs to reach across.
In the past, when an interface had been written with a specific vendor or a specific vendor's code was so integrated into our systems, it was hard to change to others. But given the pluggable architecture of OpenStack, we are now able to bring in more vendors.
Wow, almost spit it there. So I have just a few more minutes to cover some things, and then we will wrap up and get you all out of here and onto the event. You know, we talked about super users, and super users have tools. You know, super users on systems, they have utilities that allow them to do things and perform actions and make changes in those systems. And I think that from our perspective, you know, we feel like we've had a lot of progress in the development community, and the developers have infrastructure and tooling and processes, and we want to start to introduce some of those on the user side as well. And some of these things have kind of been in progress for a little while. You may remember that we actually printed a book starting last year that was written by a number of operators of OpenStack, the OpenStack Operations Guide. We have some other books that are coming out from O'Reilly, and we started some other things. Troy mentioned that we did an operators meetup in March in California. We have the ops meetups happening here this week. There's also another session on Wednesday. We've talked a lot about software and development and kind of that forward thinking, the future of the industry. But at the same time, there are a lot of enterprises who are making use of OpenStack. And there's a session on Wednesday. It's at 2 p.m. It's in B407, up a couple escalators here, that is going to be focused specifically on things that we can do inside of OpenStack to make it more enterprise ready. So if that's something that interests you, please, you know, go to that as well. And then through this week, we have a number of different ways that you can start your journey to becoming a super user if you aren't already. There's a booth up the escalators just right out here that has a number of stations where you can start to sign up for some of the mailing lists, join the community, provide survey feedback on OpenStack, and we actually have some of these books there that we're giving away if you'd like to have a copy of the OpenStack Operations Guide. And so, you know, we're trying to give you opportunities to start your journey as a super user this week. In addition to that, though, we want this to be something that goes on well past the summit. And one of the other things that we are launching today is a new online publication, OpenStack Super User, that is built for operators, it's by operators. Most of the contributors are users and operators of OpenStack clouds, the editors are, and it's really going to dive into issues around running OpenStack, but also, I think just as importantly, the kinds of organizational issues that people run into as they try to bring this change into their companies. And so this is, I think, something that's going to be exciting and valuable. And this is available at superuser.openstack.org with quite a bit of content already up there. Now, this is something that we're just getting started. And we want your help. We want your involvement. We want your feedback on what we can do to make this very valuable for you. So please check it out and let us know how you want to be involved and what you want to see there. I showed this slide earlier. These are the sponsors from the summit. And that's a lot of companies. One of the great benefits of OpenStack is this ecosystem. You know, it gives you many on-ramps to taking advantage of OpenStack, but at the same time, you know, that can be overwhelming. And one of the number one questions that we hear at the foundation is, how do I get started? You know, where do I go to get OpenStack in my environment? And so one of the other tools that we are introducing today, it's a new tool to help navigate that ecosystem. And so we are launching openstack.org/marketplace today. And this is a section of our website that's really oriented around the paths to adoption. So if you would like to consume OpenStack on an hourly basis as a service, it lists out public clouds. If you would like to have someone help you build a private cloud implementation, there are services and consulting companies. If you're looking for a distribution, there are lists of the distributions that are available, appliances that are available. And this is really meant to be a resource to help people find their way into OpenStack and be able to get the most use out of it. We launched kind of a smaller version of this about 7 or 8 months ago that was focused on training, because one of the number one pieces of feedback that we heard is that people needed a way to educate themselves or educate their teams on OpenStack. And since we launched that, it was, it was a fairly small start, but it has ramped up, and the organizations that have offered training through the marketplace have delivered over 250 training sessions in 30 countries in 6 months. And so, you know, that's a lot of OpenStack education happening all around the world, and that's the power of this ecosystem. So we are expanding the marketplace today, and it's going to continue to grow. You know, this is, again, just the start, and I'm really excited to see how this plays out and grows over time. In addition to the online marketplace, we wanted to bring that here in person. And one of the things that I think is interesting, you know, you heard the keynotes from Rackspace and Dell, and they talked a lot about working in this ecosystem. And the OpenStack ecosystem is, I think, an interesting environment. It's kind of like a farmer's market in a way. You know, you go to a farmer's market, and you can buy things in different formats. You can get ingredients to go make your meal. You can buy pre-made meals. You're going to make a choice between those options there. But at some level, the vendors who participate in that farmer's market, they have a common goal. You know, it may be locally sourced, maybe organic. They have something that is binding them together. And that's really, I think, what we see in OpenStack. We have companies who are out there competing in the marketplace and who are delivering services, but at the same time, they come here to this summit, their developers go to the design summit, they collaborate, they work together. And so, you know, our companies compete, but they also collaborate to build the best technologies for the benefit of the whole industry. And so this is really the theme behind our expo hall this time around. We have the online marketplace and we have the live and in-person OpenStack marketplace, which as you walk out of here, it's just next door over this way. And it was a pretty cool build out. So we actually took some time-lapse video because, you know, time-lapse video is a lot of fun to watch. So let's just roll that and see us putting that together over there.